yet. We're live here at the George Bush Presidential Library and Museum in College Station, Texas. Good morning, I'm Wolf Blitzer reporting. We're standing by for the start of the service at President Bush's home church, St. Martin's Episcopal Church in Houston. It's the same church where former First Lady Barbara Bush was memorialized after her death in April. Inside this house of worship, nearly 12,000 Texans paid their respects as the president lay in repose. Delivering eulogies, President Bush's best friend, James Baker, his former Secretary of State and Chief of Staff, and the president's eldest grandson, George P. Bush, the son of Jeb and his wife, Columba. Right after the service, an historic moment in this state funeral. The president and the family will be carried aboard this train, painted in the colors of Air Force One, led by an engine called Bush 4141, for a 100-mile journey to College Station, Texas. The locomotive, by the way, was built back in 2005, specifically to honor President Bush's life. We're joined by John King, Dana Bash, Mary Kate Carey, the president's former speech writer. John, this is going to be different today than what we all saw yesterday. Much more personal.
Much more personal in the president's adopted home state. If you think back to early in the career, there were times when people questioned, is he a real Texan? Put that away. You know, remember he had an apartment in Houston? Well, he became not just a president, but a pillar in the community in Houston. 50 years he attended that church with his wife. An Astros fan, a Texan fan. In the old days, there were jokes about he doesn't really like pork rinds. Guess what? He liked pork rinds. And so it'd be much more personal today. And then you come to the place that I was here for the dedication back in 1997 of this library. You're also reminded this is a passing of the generations. Jerry and Betty Ford were here for that. So was Nancy Reagan. So was Lady Bird Johnson. When they dedicated it. So there is a generational passing here that is, A, very important to remember, and be sad in a way.
Yeah, and it's going to be a moment that will sort of wrap these last few days up.
That's right. And as you mentioned, yesterday it was very big. It was very powerful. It was very official at Washington, the most official Washington kind of send-off you can have in the National Cathedral. Beautiful, beautiful cathedral. And this is personal. This is who he was. I was here when the late president passed away on Friday and over the weekend and went by St. Martin's. It's a beautiful, beautiful church. And you can see why and obviously knowing and hearing the pastor speak yesterday, the rector speak yesterday, why it was such an important place for the late president and his late wife. And I just want to echo what you were saying, having spent a little bit of time on the ground here over the past couple of days in Texas and more importantly in Houston. He and his wife, George and Barbara Bush, were, people described it to me as royalty in Houston. They helped so much with fundraising. They would go to an event and it would draw, you know, as many people as could fill the place, as many checks that could be written. And that is something that you can't overlook when you're talking about not just the final personal send-off, but his adopted home.
Mary Kate, you know the family well. What are you anticipating?
You know, I think it's going to be a mix of things today. I think it's going to be sad, of course, because it's going to be hard to watch him be buried. But there's also a sense of celebration, I think. One of the things here at Texas A&M, every time you come, they start with howdy. And it's just a very friendly place. At Mrs. Bush's funeral, which I was at, I remember seeing how many volunteers there were to check people in and get them to the right bus and all this. And I remember turning to my husband and saying, this seems kind of overstaffed. And he said, oh, no, no. These are people who want to be here volunteering. They want to say they were a part of this for the rest of their lives. And I think we're going to see that tenfold today. If they were doing that for Mrs. Bush, for President Bush, it's going to be a huge community outpouring here. There was shots on the local news last night of the flyover on Air Force One, and the streets were full of people who came out of buildings to wave. Very sweet.
Coverage today is only just beginning. Anderson Cooper is going to be with us, obviously, throughout the day as well. Anderson?
Thanks very much. A lot to look for. I want to talk to our guests here in Washington as we await the beginning of the service. Jamie, I'm wondering what you're hearing about what we may expect inside during the service.
So the eulogy from James Baker, his oldest friend, went back so far that James Baker was a Democrat when George Bush first met him. Since they've always been close, but since Barbara Bush passed, James and Susan Baker have been with him almost every day. Mm. They were there the last day And there was when he passed.
Remarkable moment that the Reverend talked about yesterday.
Where he massaged his feet for a half hour, and you saw the former Secretary of State. James Baker's a pretty tough guy. When you see him break down at that table and listen to his grandparents, and I think we're going to hear a lot about that today.
And then we'll talk about this train that's going to be taking the 41st president.
So everyone keeps wondering, what is it with George Bush and trains? And he loved them. He campaigned on them. He used them a lot. When his presidential library first opened, I was lucky enough to be a guest, and we all took the train mm-hmm. to College Station. So people know that he has this fondness for them. But I think the story that a lot of people don't know is that in 1942, his father took him to Penn Station to send him off to basic training. And 41 used to say it was the only time he ever saw his father cry. Mm-hmm. So there's
and his father hadn't wanted him to join up when he
did not want. They wanted him to go directly to college at Yale. They hoped he would change his mind. Obviously, they didn't stand in his way. He was 18 years old, but it was a very emotional time. And I do think there's a connection there as well.
Also about George P. politically is he's the I think maybe the single member, but you would know certainly better than I of the Bush family who has actually vocally been supporting Donald Trump, which is something someone may have to do when they run for office in Texas. But even given, you know, Jeb Bush's differences.
And he is Jeb's son.
He's Jeb's son. And even given, you know, low energy Jeb and all the rest of it, George P. has been out there tweeting unity with Donald Trump from pretty early on.
Although there have been times when it didn't work out. There was something recently where he spoke out and all of a sudden Donald Trump Jr. canceled a fundraiser for him. Yeah. So it goes back and forth. Yeah.
You know, I saw George P. Here at CNN yesterday, and I said, oh, man, George P., it's because I remember covering 43, and we'd see him on the campaign trail, but we certainly talk about him a lot. And being land commissioner in Texas is a very big political job and seen as a springboard. And his dad, you know, President Bush, 43, they all talked about him as the future. And he said yesterday, yeah, no pressure there.
It's so interesting to talk about the Bushes in Texas. I mean, it was a choice that George H.W. Bush made mm-hmm. to go to Texas and sort of create his own path. His family was obviously much more East Coast. He went to Yale. He could have stayed, you know, kind of in that family dynamic. And yet he really chose to kind of forge his own path.
Well, and he went there really to, as you say, forge his own path, but because that's where the economic development was. You know, if this had been the 1850s, he would have gone to the Yukon Territory, he would have gone to California. Texas was booming in the post-war period, especially in the West Texas oil fields, which is where Bush went in order to really make his mark. And then moved down to Houston after a few years, really, I think, because he wanted a more cosmopolitan experience and also more political opportunity mm-hmm. down there. But throughout the entire period, whenever someone would ask, Mrs. Bush in particular, where are you from? She would say, we're from Texas.
Yeah. Mm.
And then the question would be responded, of course, no, really, where are you from? And she would say, we're from Texas. Mm. And that was always the answer.
I would take a little issue with the adopted home state because it really was home to the Bushes. It's where they spent their holidays, their vacations, they had a home there. And to Jeff's point, it was their home. Mm-hmm. Notwithstanding that he'd been born on the East Coast and grew up there in his formative years, but Texas was home to them, all things
without
Texas.
Without a doubt. And I think Jeff King and Dana Bashett had said that being down there, and they said this people in Texas, no, they were part of their community. They were invested in their community. They were loyal. They were friends. They were there. They supported everything that they could. And actually, when George Bush became president of the United States, I mean, he helped to, in some ways, put Houston on a global map. He brought the G8, the Economic Summit, down there. He wanted his convention to be there in 1992, so he was loyal to his city.
Can I add one point to this, Anderson, which is, you know, you talk about George W. Bush, and there was certainly a lot made about, you know, his Texas roots, which in the second generation were so real for him. That's really his who he was.
He sounded Texas.
Right, he had the accent. And he obviously campaigned there and was a politician there, was governor of the state. But it was so heartfelt for him. And I remember before his inauguration in 2001, after the election, the last event was in Midland, Texas. And he
was another moment of high emotion for him. He said, I'm going off on this adventure, but Midland will always be home. It's where my heart is.
An anchor.
How do you want to be remembered for all time?
That I did it with honor. Duty, honor, country. You know, I hope people look back, historians, and say we did the right thing in facing down this aggression, setting it back, restoring credibility not only of the U.S., but of all those who want to stand against aggression. That's a point in history. But I want to be remembered as a guy that did it with honor, that did his best.
Those are powerful words, John, and a lot of people are going to contrast that with the critics of the current president of the United States.
It's the athlete in President Bush there, did it my best. He was a baseball player, loved baseball, and that was always the thing, you know, play your best game. You're not always going to get it right, you're going to make mistakes, but play your best game. And I think that he's being buried here is fitting, because if you go in this library, and Mary-Kate knows it well, she does some work here, at the dedication day, he was sheepish, because President Clinton, President Ford, all these people are lavishing praise on President Bush, he was staring at the floor, because he didn't like it to be about him. Inside here, you would love the Gulf War section in here. When he was sitting with Bernie Shaw there, he mentioned standing down aggression. When he sees Bernie, he thinks Bernie was in Baghdad when he was bombing Baghdad. And it's a great fitting tribute, the Gulf War section in here, the life and times. There's some wonderful black and white footage of young George Bush at Kennebunkport learning how to walk. So it's sad that we talk about presidential libraries mostly on days when we say goodbye to presidents. But he wanted this place to be both a remembrance of his 4 years in office, but also as a school for public service. And I think that's the part there, that he gave it his best. He was in the arena, not just as president, not just as vice president. We talked about this when Senator McCain died, a man who was just in the arena for his entire life, who, yes, he made some mistakes. Yes, there are people out there who disagree with that policy or this policy. But from a young man, young congressman from Texas, through the presidency and then his post-presidency, public service, volunteer, help people, point of life.
And
clearly, Dan, a mission accomplished. He did do, he did serve with honor.
Absolutely. And I think what you were getting at, Wolf, there's no question that when you hear him in his own words, asked straight up, how do you want to be remembered? And he talks about honor. And of course, we've heard the words decency and gentleman and country first and all of the things that that everybody, Democrat, Republican, world leader from halfway around the world, adjectives used to describe him. It is, of course, this maybe the second, third thing you think is, it is a contrast to what we're seeing today. It's not intended as a criticism of what we're seeing today. It's just the reality.
It is.
It just is what it is, to quote John McCain, another person who reminded us all of the differences between the politics of now and the politics of not that long ago.
Yeah. Go ahead, Mary.
You know, before he left office, one of the last speeches he gave was to the Points of Light, who had been named every day, and they all flew in for him to thank them, not for them to thank him. And at the end of the speech, he said, I want to be remembered as a Point of Light, and I'm going to do that now as I leave the office. And he went on to found the world's largest volunteer organization, 250 million volunteers. He also went on to found the Bush School, as you were just saying, John, and it's a tremendous legacy. He wants to get young people who can afford to go into public service without a lot of debt from their college education. And it's a tremendous thing. It's got the highest number of graduates who actually go into public service from any school in the country.
And am I right that he, that the family, instead of flowers and so forth, they wanted donations to go right there?
Go to the Bush School is where that's what their hope is, that instead of flowers, everybody will donate to the Bush School. It's great.
Before we came on the air, you were making a point that is both funny and a reflection of the depth of the family's life in politics. This is the George Bush Presidential Library, but they need to change the name to the George H.W. Bush.
Yeah, they're in the process.
Library,
yes.
Because there's a W library up the road.
That's right.
Near Dallas.
Right.
And the wonderful thing about the 41st president of the United States, he not only lived his life throughout his life with honor, but he's now being remembered so beautifully.
It is the word friendship keeps coming up. He was everything. If you look at the resume, no offense to anyone else who's held the office or anyone else seeking the office, you look at George H.W. Bush's resume and it's mind-blowing for somebody who, you know, such a career in public service and what he did after he left office. But it's the striking part is you just keep hearing the word, yes, he led the Gulf War. Yes, he broke his signature political promise and paid a price for it, raising taxes because it was the right thing to do for the country. But what does everybody want to circle back to? Friendship. Kept in touch, kept his word, checked in when I was down. That's why I'm so looking forward to Secretary Baker today. Think of Secretary Baker's been around everything. The fall of the Berlin Wall, the Gulf War, trying to keep the world together at that period of time. What is he going to talk about? A friend who kept him in the game, kept his spirits up when his first wife died. A friend who was always with him. So a life of huge achievements, but a life of the small little things that all of his friends remember.
And graciousness. I covered his son's time in the White House. I didn't know him at all, especially compared to you, and didn't cover him the way you two did. But one of my most vivid memories that I cherish is covering the McCain campaign in 2008. And while Barack Obama was in Europe with tens of thousands of people cheering for him, literally, John McCain went to visit George H.W. Bush in Kennebunkport. And what did the former president do? He took all of us reporters, who are not revered by a lot of politicians, around and gave us a tour of Walker's Point, showed us everything that, you know, that we wanted to see. He wasn't that mobile, but he wanted to make sure, and he walked us all around. He did not have to do that, and I don't know that any other person would have done it the way he did.
The biggest surprise I saw yesterday, Mary Kate, was the former Secretary of State, James Baker, the president's best friend. And I covered him extensively when he was Secretary of State, White House Chief of Staff. I got to know him, and I traveled with him when he was Secretary of State, went to Kazakhstan with him after the collapse of the Soviet Union, and he was a powerful figure. But when he broke down, we saw him crying yesterday because his best friend was gone. That was a surprise to me because that side of James Baker I had never seen.
I agree. I had never seen him cry either all these years. He's a tough hombre, I was surprised at that. And I interviewed him, for 41 on 41, and he never broke down. When I interviewed Bob Gates for 41 on 41, he broke down, and he's another guy that does not cry easily. But he said, "I would walk through fire for George Bush," and that's this feeling of camaraderie, loyalty going up as well as down, and lifting up his friends when times get tough. He's right there.
It was a beautiful moment indeed, and we're anticipating his eulogy that's coming.
I can't wait to hear.
We're all looking forward to that. The Bush family is arriving soon.
Change, Allison, let's first go to you. What's going on? What's behind the sell-off?
Anderson, the market right now, the market sentiment is so fragile that just news of an arrest is going to set off a wave of selling when the bell opens, when the bell rings in about 1 minute. The arrest I'm talking about is the chief financial officer of Huawei. That's the Chinese tech giant that sells actually more Apple iPhones. That sells more smartphones than Apple does. The chief financial officer was arrested in Canada at the request of the United States. And the way investors and analysts feel at this point is that the timing of that arrest seems very political, and it seems political, and it seems like it's just going to be escalating the China-U.S. trade war. Anderson?
Opening bell should be any moment now. We'll see what happens. I also want to go to our Caitlin Collins, who's standing by at the White House. Caitlin, any response from the White House of what we've been watching in the markets?
Well, they haven't responded so far to the latest news about this arrest, but we know that this chief financial officer was arrested in Canada at the request of the United States. So that's not helping things, but that's only contributing, Anderson, to an already existing problem that is happening back here at the White House with the man who is in that residence behind me tweeting, and those tweets are largely what has been responsible for what we've seen and how we've seen these stocks take such a dive as they did on Tuesday after the president initially started out this week on a good note, sounding optimistic about his dinner with the Chinese president, President Xi, while he was in Argentina for the G20 summit. And he and the press secretary came out of that saying essentially they had struck this incredible deal at this dinner, and they were going to hold a truce on their trade war and work on the next 90 days to work out an issue to de-escalate the trade war that we have seen playing out for the last several months. But then, Anderson, President Trump got on Twitter Tuesday, declared himself to be a tariff man, and that is what sent stocks sliding because it reignited that fear that there is going to continue to be this U.S.-China trade war. We've only seen that continue, and though even though the stock market was closed yesterday in honor of the late President George H.W. Bush, we saw President Trump doing what he could to try to shore up confidence by tweeting that he was confident President Xi was going to stick by his deal that they had agreed to on Saturday night. Anderson, that's not exactly what's happening behind closed doors here at the White House, because officials will not voice the same amount of confidence that the president is, because they're still having a hard time enlisting exactly what it is they agreed to, and they're not sure that the Chinese are going to follow through on what they say President Trump said they agreed to during that dinner on Saturday night. So expect to see this uncertainty continue. That is the only thing that essentially White House officials are prepared to guarantee at this point.
Uncertainty is the only certain thing. I want to go back to Allison Kosick right now. Allison, it looks like it's down, what, 454 points at the start of this.
Exactly. I mean, you're seeing the losses escalate at this point. A lot of what we saw happen on Tuesday was this escalation of selling. And interestingly enough, as the president tweeted and tried to explain what happened in Argentina between President Xi and his meeting, we did see the losses even accelerate. So what's happening here on the floor is there's a lot of anxiety. There's a lot of uncertainty as to whether or not a resolution can even happen at this point to get this trade deal in place. Even the discussions, even the timing of the discussions, there's a lot of confusions about when that timing even begins and ends. And then you've got this arrest of the chief financial officer of one of the biggest tech companies in China. It feels political, and it's making everybody on the floor very nervous. Anderson?
Yeah, it's going to be a long day, no doubt, on the floor. I also want to bring in David Gregory, Gloria Borger. You know, the president has prided himself on what the stock market has been doing the entire time he's been in office. He seems to be taking a lot of credit for it. Not sure he'll be taking credit for this.
He's made it his yardstick. The markets are doing well, therefore we're doing well. And I think what we're seeing today, seeing what occurs, is this sort of perfect storm that's not so good for the country. You have this, you know, you have this arrest, you have oil prices that are going down, and you have really a panic about what's going to be the relationship between China and the United States on trade, because you're getting such mixed signals, even about the timetable of any kind of a deal. Was it 90 days? Was it 60 days? What's the deal? And then you have the president out there tweeting about his own Fed chairman, trying to blame somebody else for all of this, and then calling himself a tariff man. And so all of this put together does not settle the markets at all.
The president talks about winning, that the country is going to get tired of winning. And he does point to the stock market, and he's been critical of rising interest rates because the economy is so strong that the Fed has decided to increase interest rates to curb inflation fears. The president's been sharply critical of that, another area where he breaks with norms and traditions. But globally, the economy is slowing down. There's some real fears as we go into 2019 of more of a global downturn, which has, you know, political implications, of course, as we get closer to an election year in 2020. But this volatility right now is so much about what our brinksmanship is like with China. And a lot of corporations in America that have a lot of capital to spend and have done really well are really concerned about
that.
One other thing, the tech companies are meeting at the White House today with the president, and a lot of these tech companies are getting hammered over a number of issues, including earnings, which is a real fear. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Funeral guests unloading off those buses, and just a little bit of color from here. You can see on there it says ceiling and visibility unlimited 41. So that's what's flashing across. It's the sign in the bus right now. Close friends and family gathering here for the funeral, which is set to begin at 10 o'clock local time. We are expecting to hear from George P. Bush, the grandson, and also from George Bush's, one of his best friends and Secretary of State, James Baker. Now, I want to talk a minute about St. Martin's Episcopal Church specifically. The Bushes worshipped here for some 50 years and had very close ties. The church.